Hi folks, thank you for joining us today. So today I'm going to discuss about sequential rendering with Ember.js. So this is an approach to optimize the critical rendering path of your app and thereby improve the perceived performance for your users. So before getting started, I'm Kanal, a front-end engineer at Freshworks. So a lot of you have heard of progressive or sequential rendering. Let's see what it's about. So if you look at this screen, there are two rendering options. One is the optimized progressive rendering, and the other is the unoptimized rendering. So in the second case, all the elements in that route are rendered at one shot, thereby bringing the load time to around 1.5 seconds. Whereas in the first approach, you render the hero element or the high priority element for the user first, followed by all the secondary and tertiary priority elements, so that at any point of time, user will keep seeing meaningful content. So let's see how to achieve this. But before we go to that, I'd like to give you an overview of critical rendering path and some approaches to optimize it. Yeah. So when you land on any app or website in your browser, let's see what happens under the hood. First, the served HTML is parsed, tokenized, and then constructed into the document object model or DOM. Similarly, the CSS is also tokenized and constructed into the CSS object model, which has all the nodes with their specificity computed. Now, with the document object model and the CSS object model, you compute the render tree. This is nothing but a tree with all the visible nodes, their corresponding content, and the styles derived from the CSS object model. Now comes the layout or reflow stage. Here, the render tree is taken as the input, and as the output is the render tree with its viewport positions. So here, each and every node in the render tree is recursively traversed, and then their corresponding positions in the viewport are calculated. Next comes the paint stage. Now, the render tree is painted in the screen by converting the positions into pixels. So each of these stages, the time taken to parse or paint or the layout is directly dependent on the number of elements and the complexity of the elements which you render. So let's see what happens when you add in JavaScript. For every JavaScript module, you have the option to manipulate both the DOM and the CSS object model. So when this happens, the render tree also changes, and thereby it triggers layout and paint. So before going into the optimization of Ember apps, let's see what happens in every Ember app load. So I've just taken a sample Ember app as an example. So first we request for the index.html, and when it's served, say its size is around XKB, it's served. And now this has the links to all the vendor app and then third party assets as needed. So these assets are fetched. For example, if an example for a third party asset will be Heap Tracking, which is a click tracking service, or analytics for your performance tracking, and so on. Now, when these assets are download, passed, and executed, the Ember app lifecycle kicks in. This starts the initializers, instance initializers, and so on. And then the application route kicks in, followed by the nested routes where your page lands in. So now this route also requests data APIs through the model hook. And once these are resolved, the data is passed to the rendering layer, and then your app's content is rendered. Now, until then, everything your user sees is going to be placeholder content or loaders, which are not really meaningful. So let's look at the complexity of this. So CRP can be categorized with these three parameters. One is the round trip. So in this case, you have at least three round trips to get all your data which is required for the critical render. The second set is the critical resources. Here you have the index.html, which is one, followed by two vendor assets, two app assets, and then let's say just one third party asset. And then two data IPs. So you have the sum here. And next, it's the critical bytes. So each of these have their own size. And the critical bytes is the sum of all these parts. Now, to optimize your critical rendering path, you need to tweak any of these. For example, the round trips can be reduced if you tweak the critical bytes and reduce it. So this can be done for the assets by either code splitting or deferring non-critical assets and so on. As for the data APIs, you need to analyze each and every API call you make and ensure that it's absolutely critical if it's in the initial render path. So for demo, I picked an open source project. So I picked this project for a few reasons. One, a lot of us will be really familiar with this layout. Two, their measurement metrics code was really awesome. And then they also had an amazing development proxy, which made developing super easy. So yeah, let's go ahead. So this is the add-on route of Ember Observer. So let's look at the waterfall. So this talk is going to focus on optimizing the render and data, and not about assets. So I'm just going to ignore all the assets and go just for the XHR. So if you look at these requests, the first request is to get the categories. Next is the critical request to get the corresponding add-on data for the current add-on. This is followed by the test results for the add-on, and then the Ember versions, GitHub stats for the repo, README, and so on. So let's jump into the code. The categories call was from the application route. So knocking this off will be harder. So let's focus on the nested show route first. If you look at the show route, there are two blocking promises, one to fetch the add-on and one to render the latest test result. Now take a look at where each of these data are used. The add-on data is used for the primary left pane. The test result is used only here. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to defer the test result call and only have the add-on primary critical request in the model route. So I also have another clone with my changes. So if you look at the show route here, it'll only have the critical request. Now let's go back to the templates. So we have an add-on which will help you prioritize and render each and every pane as per your priorities. So if you look at it, so the add-on is called Ember Sequential Render. So I've added it to the dependencies. This add-on has a few other dependencies, but the primary one is Ember Concurrency. So let's see what this add-on can do. This is the basic stats section of the add-on route, which has the header, the description, the category details, and so on. So I'm wrapping this entire section inside this composable component. So I'm also giving it the render priority of 0, which is the highest priority. And since the model returns the necessary data for this route, we do not need any asynchronous call. So it's going to be async render false. So let's see. So all the primary content will be added inside this render content yielded component. Yeah. So you also have the option to provide a loader state for each of these sequential render instances. So I'm reusing the default loader, which is present in Ember Observer. So next comes the stats bar. So this is what was using the test results. Now, before rendering this, we need the test results. I've also made this async render because the stats bar also has a lot of other details which do not depend on the test result. So let's go into the stats bar component. The stats bar template. Yeah. So look, if you look at this, this is the only pane which uses the test results call. So I'm also wrapping this inside a sequential render instance. Now for this, in order to fetch the data, I'm passing a task instance, which is added in the shows controller. Yeah. So the call from the model has been moved here. And once it's yielded, I've set it to the property of latest test result. Let's look at the stats bar. Yeah, so I'm only wrapping the corresponding stats bar test results inside this particular sequential render, and I'm giving this a priority of 2. So now let's look at the difference in loading these two. So I cloned the default unchanged Ember Observer version in here, and the other, this is the original Ember Observer local. So let's go into a particular add-on route. So I haven't added any throttling or network manipulations. So let's see what's happening. So if you look at it, the entire render happened at the same time with just one loading indicator. Whereas in this section, if you look at it, each and every section has its own loading indicator and renders as and when it completes. So let's take a few benchmarks. The data request time, which is the measure between will transition and data loaded. Data loaded is here in the after model hook. And then the render time, which is the time between did transition and before paint, which is here. So let me take this. Yeah. So for each of these apps, let me add some throttling. So this is with the optimizations. I'm transitioning into the Ember Resolver add-on. So if you look at the paint, or you look at the data and render measure, it's 1100 ms and 57 correspondingly. Let's do the same here. So I also added the same metrics there too. Going into Ember Resolver again. Now, if you look at it, you see the difference. Let's add these stats into the doc. So I already have some sample runs. So for the third run, with the optimal conditions, let's put this up. So before is, let me clarify. This is the original app, 1800.78 ms, which is before data is 1800. Whereas after optimization, it's just 1100 ms. I'm adding the after data here. Similarly for render, I'm also picking up the before render time, which was 600 ms, followed by the after render, which is just 57 ms. Now, if you look at the diff, it might not seem like much, But you need to understand that our users do not always have their optimal network and machine power. So let's look at few stats with a bit of throttling thrown. This is the production version. I'm closing it. Yeah. So I'm picking, let's say, slow 3G for the network and 4x throttling for the CPU. Similarly here too, I'm adding the same slow 3G and 4x throttling. So yeah, since we are measuring just the transition, let's go back into the list. This will take some time. We'll do the same here too, meanwhile. So look at the difference when you throttle the network and CPU. So this might be what your users are seeing when they are using your app if they do not have good network conditions. So let's see the render of Ember Resolver again. So look at the visible difference. See how long it takes to fetch data. This is actually natural because with low bandwidth, this is what you get. Let's wait. Maybe I should have gone for fast 3G. Yeah, but I'll wait. Yeah. So you have a whopping, for data, it's 32,000 ms, which is around 32 seconds, and render duration was around 2 seconds. So I have a corresponding section for slow 3. This is still fast 3G. Okay, I'm not adding it anywhere. Maybe let me just, yeah, I'll add it here for now. You have before render at 2 seconds, and then you have 32 seconds for the data. Now let's go for Ember Resolver here in this optimized instance too. So do you see the difference now? It's quite visible. So let me just print it. So data is taking barely 2 ms. Okay, wait, let me recheck. Did I add the performance 4x? Yeah, I did. Okay. Seems too fast. Let me try again. This takes too long to load. Now again, yeah. So still the same. 2 seconds. Another run had 2.6. The difference is quite obvious when you have really bad conditions. So I've averaged the runs and then computed the average improvement for both the model meshes and the hero element render meshes. So this is the result. So take a look at the conditions on the left hand side and the corresponding performance improvements. If you look at the first two throttling conditions, one is fast 3G and the other is slow 3G. So the difference is predominantly in the data fetch, because earlier there were two requests and now it's just one request. And also the render is because for the initial render, we are cutting down a lot of layouts and only rendering the basic informations, which include the title, description, and the categories. And now let's look at the 4x CPU throttling. why does slow 3G combined with 4x CPU throttling have such a huge impact? All we did was cut one data call in the modern section. So why is it 91% different? The measure we had was not just about the fetch of the call, it's also about creating or pushing the records into store, normalizing the relationships, and so on. So it took a heavy toll when your CPU is not high performing. So yeah, before moving on to the next section, I want to show you something which might backfire if we don't take care of it. So let's look at this load. This is the optimized load. So you have the base loader followed by the individual sections. Now we have optimized the render, but is it paint optimized? The answer for that is no, it's not paint optimized. The reason is, so if you looked at, if you had seen the load, there were so many layout chips. With so many layout chips, the position of each element will be recalculated whenever another element comes into place or it's rendered. So we need to figure out a way to solve the layout chips. So some cool ways to do those are adding shimmer loaders with expecting the content which is going to pop up there. So which is where you use the loader states which are provided by the add-on. So yeah, that's all of the demo. Let me show you a few high-level features in the add-on. So yes, this add-on has two major use cases. One is what we saw, the sequential and prioritized rendering of the elements in your route. So for this, there's a composable container component called sequential render, which takes your priorities, and if you have any data fetches, it takes the task for that, and so on. And the other functionality is a post-render callback. So remember we talked about the third-party assets. So I'm going to take heap tracking as an example here. So it's the primary use case of heap tracking is to track the clicks of your user or any interactions which your users perform in your app. So think about it this way. Would you even need click tracking when your app hasn't loaded yet? So in this case, the answer is no. So what we can do is wait for all the priority items or all the items in the queue to render and then inject the third-party assets. So this will cut down one critical asset which was render blocking earlier. So look at the API for these components. You have, it's in still not moved to the angle bracket syntax in the demo screens. So yeah, you have the render priority, which is a number which gives you the priority of the component which is rendered. And the task name should be unique so that we'll be able to queue it and then execute it as needed. And then you have the render callback, which will be executed the moment your content is rendered, and query params for the task as needed. These are just samples. So there are a lot of other features, like we talked about async render when we do not need any additional data. You also have render immediately, where say you have a low priority item, but somehow the user interacts with it even before it's rendering. It could be a button toggle or something similar. So in those cases, just change the render immediately flag and your item will be triggered out of its order so that users will be able to use it. Yeah, So for the state maintenance, we have one service called the render state service, which has the render later flag, which can be used to ensure that all the priority items in your current route have loaded, and then you can wrap any third-party asset which is not part of the callback inside this. We use evented to listen to each and every render event in the sequential render instances, and the moment all the elements of the lowest or critical priority have loaded, we fire an event which is listened by the other components, and only if the priorities match, they render. Till then, their loader states will come into play. The moment your promise is fulfilled in the case of async renders, or the moment your priority is fulfilled in the case of regular renders, the loader state is removed and the content state comes in. So that's it, guys. Thank you for joining. Let's move on to the Q&A session now.